us any moment. So if you can all just give us a couple of more minutes, we will have this press conference starting in just another couple minutes.
Voting to put on a charter amendment on the June 2016 ballot that would remove the current inclusionary requirement ceiling from the city charter and set it a set of interim controls until the board finally decides what is the appropriate level our private developer community should be building to build for our affordable, working class, and middle class households here in San Francisco. We know over the last 10 years that we have built close to 26,000 units of housing, but only 15% of these units are affordable to 60% of our residents. Only 15% of these units were built affordable for 60% of our residents. Some of my colleagues will say that we need to build as much market rate and luxury housing as possible to help decline the rent here in San Francisco. But we know that that is not the case. For every unit of market rate and luxury need, we are building at twice that need. But what we need to do to make San Francisco more affordable is to build more affordable housing. More market rate housing does not make San Francisco more affordable. More affordable housing will make San Francisco more affordable. And that is what today's charter amendment is about. We want to remove any ceiling on the obligations that our developers who make a lot of money in our city have to share that wealth back with the city by building the housing that we need to see. And in the meantime, saying that we want our developers to do double what they're doing today. And we know that they can. Last year, we were able to see developers rise to build to 40% affordable and middle-income housing, not just on 1,000-unit large developments. We also see it in smaller developments of 300 units. So we know that this is possible. And we're also asking the developers not just build affordable housing, but build a wider range so that we can include middle-income households like our teachers, our nurses, our entry-level workers, and our small business owners as well. So I want to recognize again Supervisor Peskin, who opened up our hearing, for co-sponsoring this incredibly important measure today, and thanking our community for ensuring that we have the votes that we need on the Board of Supervisors to truly represent the city so that we can put this ordinance on the ballot today. So without further ado, I want to bring up the very folks that are impacted by the measure that we are putting forward. And the first individual that I want to bring up is Lorenza Listana, who is one of our amazing, amazing Tenderloin neighborhood organizers. But one of the reasons why he is able to organize in the city, that he's able to go door knocking and to help organize for more affordable housing in the South of Mars and the Tenderloin, is because he can afford to live here. Him and his family were one of our households that were fortunate to get into 100% affordable housing owned by Tenderloin Neighborhood Development Corporation. Housing that was only that we were only able to build because this board fought to ensure that we were getting more money and more value from our market rate developers to build affordable housing. So Lorenzo Listana.
I'm a resident and a community organizer in the Tenderloin. Housing rights is human rights. Yes, everyone has the right to have a decent, affordable housing. Together in the Tenderloin, we have here our Chinese residents, the Tenderloin Chinese Rights Association, and the Tenderloin Filipino Associations, and other organizations in the Tenderloin are here in support for Supervisor Jane Kim and Piskins and other progressive supervisors to provide a charter amendment to provide for more affordable housing in San Francisco. My family is an immigrant family in the U.S. And had it not been for affordable housing in the Tenderloin, I'm not sure if I would be able to stay here in San Francisco. The proposed charter amendment will help not just the low-income people, but middle-income families like my family that are also being priced out in San Francisco. Next month, my family will apply for the 10th time for BMR unit. I applied in 1,400 Mission. It's like 1,000 applicants who applied there, approved applicants, but my number was 325. But only the available units is 167 units. But still I'm trying to do, because I love San Francisco and I would want to stay here. Yeah. support this charter amendment because it will increase the chance for more middle-class family, like my family, to get into a BMR unit. Because BMR are a city asset in a critical way to diversify and integrate people from all walks of life and different socioeconomic backgrounds. This is why San Francisco is an amazing city, because of its diversity. And this charter amendment will provide nonprofit workers, teachers, nurses, construction workers, retail workers, and even small entrepreneurs to live here in San Francisco.
Yeah.
Yeah. But let us also make sure that the extremely low-income San Franciscans will be able to stay here in San Francisco. Let us fight for a more equitable city. Let us fight for more housing for everyone. Let us support the charter amendment now. Thank you.
Thank you, Lorenzo. Housing people does not just mean a roof over people's heads. It also means housing people that are making the city stronger. And Lorenzo and his family are an example of that. Lorenzo's daughter served on our youth commission representing our district. Housing people also means making San Francisco stronger. Which brings me, I believe, to my next speaker, Larry Richards. Is he here? I see Larry. Larry, before you come up, Larry, I do need to say a little bit about you. Larry, I first met at one of my office hours my first year on the Board of Supervisors when he had just been evicted from the Rose Hotel on 6th Street. We then spent the next 4 years while Larry went in and out of our homeless shelter system trying to win him housing in our affordable and below market rate unit housing. On the week of my election day, Larry came to my election night party after 4 years of work to tell me that he won a below market rate condo in Rincon Hill. And in one of the most touching offers, offered me the fob to his building so I could use his women's only sauna in thanks. But these are the types of stories that we need to see more of. Larry spent 4 years in and out of our homeless shelter system. We fought to get him into one of the units that we have, and now Larry is living in one of our below market rate units in Rincon Hill. Larry Richards.
Well, I was going to say, hello, my name is Larry Richards, but she already did that. I got to tell you, like Delbert McClinton said, I'm one of the fortunate few.
Yes.
I'm in the Inclusionary Housing Program, and I have the most beautiful two-bedroom, two-bathroom apartment in this town. And through God and sure dumb luck, I managed to, through this little ticket, which I still have, win the third of through only three units in my building. And I first came to this town in 1996. I probably was actually homeless for more than 4 years, because it was a couple of years there before they even housed me at the Rose Hotel. And the Rose Hotel was a very substandard place for me. It was not wheelchair accessible. I fought them hard for my ADA rights, and eventually, like Jane said, I lost the place because, understand, I paid my rent. I was like almost a year in advance. But because I fought them, they didn't want me there. And so I went and suffered homelessness again. And it was incredibly hard the second time. But I did manage to survive. And thanks to, especially I want to single out Teresa Imperial at Bishop Housing. Teresa fought for me every day. She, many, I don't know, two, maybe 3 years, she would go out and apply for me, and she finally got the ticket that let me win. And, you know, 71% of the homeless on the streets today were like me. They used to be housed in San Francisco.
What?
And I believe this progressive city cannot call itself a progressive city unless it takes care of its citizenry. Look, I'm the big think you summed it up just right. I was very optimistic that cooler heads would prevail. When I first was on the Board of Supervisors 15 years ago, Supervisor Mark Leno, today's State Senator Leno, introduced our first inclusionary ordinance at 10%. And yes, there were those in the development community that said it would be the end of the world as we knew it. There were those who got into the business of fear tactics and scaremongering that not a new stick of construction would be built. Well, we all know the story. You can see it all over the skyline. And by the time I left office at the beginning of 2009, that 10% had increased to 15% inclusionary. In 2012, at the end of the recession, at the beginning of one of the largest economic expansions in San Francisco's history, that 15% was reduced to 12%. Some of the individuals who are now opposing this measure to take this out of the charter so that your elected leaders can actually do their job and change these percentages to prices that the market will bear without killing new housing starts. Some of the individuals who presided over reducing that from 15 to 12%, who made millions and millions of dollars right around the corner, are the largest voices in opposing what we are attempting to do today. So we might just be having a really big fight on the June ballot if cooler heads do not prevail. And if we're going to have that fight, I cannot tell you how delighted I am that the San Francisco teachers, the United Educators of San Francisco, are on our side. Yeah! UESF knows what this means. They know that in order to have a vibrant community, an intact community, our teachers who teach our children need to be able to live in our community. So with that, it is my honor and pleasure to introduce Lita Blum, the president of UESF.
Let's face it, here in San Francisco, we have a real crisis in our city, and we have a real crisis in our schools, because every year we are hemorrhaging educators, not just our teachers, but our paraprofessionals, who cannot afford the exorbitant rates and the rate increases and are being evicted week by week as we speak. Teachers are an important part of the community, and they have very demanding jobs, they love their jobs, and they should not be spending their time commuting, as more and more are forced to do as they move further and further away from the city that they love. I would like now to introduce one of our teachers, Jeremiah Jeffries, a beloved first grade teacher at Reading Elementary, to speak about the housing needs of not just our educators, but also the families that we serve.
Good morning, everyone. I cannot thank the leadership of Supervisor Jane Kim and Supervisor Aaron Peskin enough for leading the way in this fight that's so important for our teachers, our families, and our abilities to be here and really serve our children. When there's no affordable housing, our families suffer. I don't know if you know, but what's the largest growing population of homeless here in the city are children and families. They need a place to stay. Teachers need a place to stay. I've been lucky enough to live in a rent-controlled unit within walking distance of where I work for 10 years now. And it's given me such capacity to be able to serve my families, to be able to show up, to be able to walk kids to school, or take them home when their parents are sick or cannot. It makes such a difference when people can work where they live and be a part of the community. This is so important for that. But my colleagues all over the city, they have to commute. Teachers cannot afford to live here. They're commuting from as far out as Vallejo, where even I've known educators who've commuted from Tracy just so they can have a place to live and then come here to serve our children and families. This is the least the city can do. Affordable housing, we have to double it. We have to take it out of the charter amendment. We have to support this initiative in June. It's so important. Our classrooms, kids not being able to get to school, high rates of being tardy and late, and absenteeism, it's all impacted by the amount of housing that is available to families and children to be able to be here. So, again, thank you so much for this work and leadership. Come out, vote, let's do the work for our children and families. Thank you.
I'd like to introduce to demonstrate the widespread support for the charter amendment, I want to bring up one of our longtime homeowners on the west side, one of our leaders of the Coalition for San Francisco Neighborhoods. It is not just those that are seeking housing that are supporting this charter amendment. Even our longtime residents who have owned homes and are stable in place support more affordable housing in the city because they know that it will make it a stronger city and neighborhood for everyone. So I'd like to bring up someone who is well known in many different city issues, but in particular around neighborhood planning, George Wooding, the president of Coalition of San Francisco Neighborhoods.
Thank you, Jane, and thank you everyone for coming out on this nice day. I'd like to say neighborhoods throughout the city support the building of more affordable housing. San Francisco needs to ensure that developers are contributing their fair share to housing our city's resident workforce and building diversified income communities. Therefore, neighborhood leaders believe that we must move quickly to update our inclusionary housing requirements to be appropriate for our current housing crisis. In addition to providing more inclusionary housing, it is also imperative that we preserve the uniqueness of each of our neighborhoods, which has made our city so great, including small businesses in our neighborhoods. It is important that this new inclusionary provision be removed from the charter and placed in an ordinance where it can become the beacon of flexibility to accommodate varying types of housing demand. There must be solidarity among communities to enact real efforts at stopping displacement and providing housing for a range of income levels appropriate to each community, and stabilizing the gentrification of neighborhoods to preserve character of neighborhood. Thank you very much.
Thank you, George, and thank you for your leadership and making sure that we care about everyone here in San Francisco. And finally, I'd like to bring up our last speaker today, the Deputy Director of Chinatown Community Development Center, one of our CDCs that builds, protects, and manages much of affordable housing here in San Francisco, Malcolm Young.
So, you know, I'm here just to, first of all, thank Aaron, thank Jane for their leadership on this issue. You're really addressing something critical. And I'm going to be very, very affordable housing we're going to get out of our market rate projects in this building, which is absolutely, absolutely critical, right? We're telling the people who are benefiting the most from this economic boom, who are making the most money out of this economic boom, that they need to pay their fair share, they need to step up to the table, and they need to do what's right for San Francisco and not just for themselves, right? And lastly, I don't want this to kind of slip out of the way. With this charter amendment, we're returning control of housing policy, back to the people, back to our elected officials, back to the people we put into office, as opposed to writing dogmatic policies into a charter that we can't change. We're changing that, we're taking democracy back, and we're getting more affordable housing in the process. Thank you, Aaron and Jane.
And thank you to the entire community, but also thank you to our co-sponsors. I mentioned them before. Supervisor David Campos, Supervisor John Ablo, Supervisor Eric Marr, some of whom are still in the Transportation Authority talking about transit equity, but I would like to offer Supervisor Campos a moment to say a few words.
How's everyone doing? What a beautiful day. Listen, I think that this is about basically calling people out. There are people who have said that there is a place for market rate housing here in San Francisco, and, you know, contrary to what you hear, we're not against that idea. But we're simply saying that if we're going to build market rate housing, let's make sure that there is equity in also building some affordable housing.
That's right.
Yeah. And right now, I think that most San Franciscans, if you ask them, they'd be surprised to hear that when it comes to a project, you only have to build 12% affordable housing. I think if you talk to any San Franciscans, they would actually be shocked to hear that. So what we're simply saying through this measure is, commonsensically, if we're going to build a project, 25% of the units should be affordable. How modest is that? How modest is that? And so, in fact, some would say it's too modest. But it's a start. It's a start. And the other thing that I would say is to the development community, I think that they lose credibility when they start saying that the sky is falling, that somehow increasing this requirement to merely 25%, that will be the end of the world in San Francisco, that there will not be any market rate development in San Francisco because of that. I'm sorry, but I have yet to see any evidence of that. To the contrary, what we're simply saying is, we don't have a problem if developers make a profit, but how about sharing some of that profit with the community and with the working class people of San Francisco? Thank you.
Thank you, David Campos. Most of all, thank you to all of the residents that have come out from the Excelsior, from the Bayview, from Chinatown, South of Market, the Tenderloin, the Richmond, Henny Kelly. all across the city to say that we want housing for everyone. I said it before, 60% of our residents qualify for affordable housing here in San Francisco. We need to be building more to make sure that we have a city where our hotel workers, our restaurant workers, those that are organizing in our community, our nurses, our teachers, even our entry-level office workers can afford to live here in San Francisco. And so we thank the community for coming out in strong support today to show that this is our city. We need to build for our city. Whose city is this?
Our city!
And that is what today's measure is about, is making sure that we are sharing the wealth here. And I reject the notion that we should not negotiate strongly on behalf of the city, whether it's the NFL that says that we should pay for their marketing parties here in San Francisco, or it is our developers that say that they should build as much market rate housing as possible, or they will leave. We can demonstrate that we can negotiate and we can win more for our community, and people will continue to want to live and build here in San Francisco. Thank you, everyone, for being here.
Where do we?
So, for folks that are staying for public comments, thank you. I think we are expecting to go up to committee hearing at about 4 p.m. We do need all of you to come and speak in public comments. So we will take a lunch break. And for those members of the press, we're happy to route you to individuals for a further interview. Thank you.